said good morning. Would everybody stand and just lift your hands for a moment? Lord Jesus, we worship you this morning. We invite you to fill this room and this place and to fill our hearts with the revelation of who you are. Holy Spirit, we ask that you would have your way this morning in this place, in our midst, and among us. We bless your name, Jesus, today. Let's just bless the name of the Lord. Jesus, we give you glory. We bless you, for you are worthy of praise. You are worthy of worship. We love you, Jesus.
Oh. set a fire down in my soul. Can't contain, can't control. I want more of you, God. So set a fire down in my soul. Can't contain, can't control. I want more of you, God.
I want more of you, God.
No place I'd rather.
You're the way.
you get shy on me, lift up your song.
Darkness. in every heart. I worship you. I worship you. You are healing, healing every heart. I worship you. I worship you. You are.
Continue, but my guitar string busted and it went out of tune. So why don't you turn to one another and welcome them this morning.
Well, hallelujah. I didn't know I was doing announcements this morning, but I guess maybe. No. Oh, you ready?
Sorry. When we turn around and greet, sometimes, you know, hallelujah. Isn't God good? Praise God. All the time. And it is, oh, we want to release our children with Mr. Paul and Miss Maria over here. Praise God. I know we have more somewhere. Yes. Praise God. I guess the parents thought one last week before school starts in the morning. Well, Tuesday, I'm sorry. Day ahead of myself. I start in the morning. So, praise God. But I'm just, you know, 23 was a year, but I always get excited about the new year and what the new year is coming. You know, we hear lots of doom and gloom, but thank God for us who are in Christ Jesus. We have a hope. Praise God. And no matter what the outside circumstances are, we can have a party going on inside because of the joy of the Lord. It's not dependent on circumstances. We want to welcome you this morning if you're new to Grace Church. We're especially glad you came today, and our prayer is that you'll be blessed and encounter the Lord. This year we want to really encourage growth in your spiritual life, and one of the things we're doing, we're reading the Bible through this year, and we're using the YouVersion app. For those of you that don't have an app on your phone, it's, you can see it on the bulletin, and I believe this is just week one. Week two is, it's on the desk as you come in, okay? So I just want to encourage all of you. There's an app on your phone called the YouVersion. You can download it, and it's been such a blessing to me because I can push the little icon for it to speak and read to me. So as I'm doing my stuff around the house, I have my scripture for the day playing, and it's just a real encouragement. And you're thinking, well, the Bible's kind of a hard book. No, it's not. That's a lie of the devil. Now, do I understand everything written in it? Not yet, but I'm working on it. We're all in a process, learning day by day, but if we never give place to it, we never grow. And one of the things, as you know, we grew up singing that song, read your Bible, pray every day, and you'll grow, grow, grow. That's the truth. It's the truth of the word. 2 Timothy 3:16 says, God has transmitted his very substance into every scripture, for it is God breathed. It will empower you by its instruction and correction, giving you the strength to take the right direction and lead you deeper into the path of godliness. Then you will be God's servant, fully mature and perfectly prepared to fulfill any assignment God gives you. You know, God created you with an assignment in mind. And so you may think, well, I messed up. Well, that's all right. Just repent. Get back on the path. Amen. Oh, praise God. So some things we have coming up this week. Our early morning prayer will start back up Monday through Thursday, 6 a.m. to 7 a.m. Almost said p.m. Right here in the auditorium. Also, our intercessory prayer group meets Monday at 6:30 p.m. And I just want to say publicly what a blessing that group has been to us. You know, we shoot prayer requests, and then we hear how God intervenes in his miracles, and it's an incredible blessing. Also, this week we have something exciting. We're going to be part of it. the adults, January the 10th, Wednesday, we're meeting at Livingstone. They're having a group getting together. It's to support the Franklin Graham God Loves You tour. So we're going to meet together and praise and worship, and we really want to support that. I believe this is a year of great harvest. A lot of people are coming in to know the Lord, and so we're starting the year out that way. Amen. Our men's group and women's group will be starting up in February, so that's exciting. So I'm going to give you an opportunity to worship the Lord with your tithes, with your offering. Thank God for his faithfulness. The ushers, you can come forward. Praise God. Father, we just praise you this morning. Thank you, Lord. Thank you for your faithfulness, for your love for us. And your word says, if we abide in you and your words abide in us, we can ask what we will and it shall be done. Father, I just thank you for the opportunity to abide with you. Father, I just thank you that this year of 2024 will be like never before. Doors will open and we'll see how you're moving. We're excited. We anticipate what you're going to do this year. And Father, we just honor you and worship you this morning in tithes and offering. In Jesus' name, amen.
Well, hallelujah. Glory. How many are glad to be alive in 2024? I am. Praise God. It's good to be back home. We took last weekend and went up to be with some of our longtime friends in ministry, Tracy Harris and a number of other ministers, and to go see our middle son and his family who live in Arkansas. And we don't hold that against them because they live in Arkansas, but hallelujah. And so we appreciate everyone. Glory to God. Just a couple of things to follow up on what Darkus said. Now, there's a reason. People say, well, why are we going to do this on this coming Wednesday night? I'll tell you why we're going to do it. If you don't want to go and be a part of that, and I'm not trying to be mean. I don't mean that in a snotty way. I'm just trying to be quick. We're trying to do it because it's very important. Have you understand the number one thing God's after is souls? When you think of in this generation, in our lifetime, someone that has been out in the forefront, a ministry of winning souls, and they're known for it. Who do you think of? There's a number, but through my life up until just recently, when Brother Billy Graham went home to be with the Lord, I thought of Billy Graham, T.L. Osborne. I could go down and name some others, and so. When we're talking about prioritizing things for the year, in February there's going to be an open air crusade meeting here in town that is hosted by a number of churches, a number of organizations. It's not just one; it's a number of us. But it's actually facilitated by Franklin Graham and Billy Graham Association. Now, let me understand there are a lot of different flavors in the body of Christ. I don't have to agree with you on every exact thing. I have to agree with you on Jesus. The unity of the faith is who is Jesus? And he is the way, the truth, and the life. He is the only entrance to the Father. So, I don't want to preach that, but so we are gathering together intentionally. Intentionally to be a part of a crusade in this community that we are believing God for souls. We're not believing God for, there are other things, of course, that will come with that, but we're believing God for souls, for people that have never committed their life to Jesus, to make Jesus the Lord of their life. And so that's what this is coming up. That's what it's about. It's not about anything else other than that. There are a number of churches that will be involved. This Wednesday night, Livingstone is hosting it so that those that are going to participate and are able to be there on Wednesday can come in, worship and prayer about the crusade in February. That's what it's about. I will say this, if you're interested in being involved when the crusade is, we're actually doing the crusade, if you're interested in being involved on the prayer team, which means being available there that night to pray with people that come forward to receive Christ, etc., whatever the need is, then because it is hosted, facilitated by Franklin Graham, they have some requirements. I'm saying that's okay. In fact, it's very much okay that they know who's up front praying with people. That not just anybody walks up front and puts hands. In fact, the scripture says, don't lay hands suddenly on any man. Don't let anybody just quickly put hands on people. You need to know who's praying for you. And so there is a system that they are requiring of anyone, making available for anyone that wants to be involved on February the 29th, which is a Thursday night at the crusade here in town. It's called the Christian Life and Witness Course. How many think it'd be good to get some more instruction, either new or bolster what you already know about living a Christian life and how to witness? Okay? And so that's what this is about. So if you're interested in being on the prayer team that night of the crusade, two days and two nights that this training is going to be available, and you will not be allowed to go up and pray for people unless you've been through this. So I'm just telling you, don't go up, don't decide you're going to go up and put hands on people at this, because it's a meeting that is under authority of Franklin Graham Evangelistic Association, Billy Graham, okay? That's what we're doing. If you want to be involved, they want you to be involved, but there's four dates that you can be trained. Thursday, the 18th of January at 6 p.m. at Oasis Church. Saturday, January the 20th at 9 a.m. at Oasis Church. There's just some churches that are participating, made their facilities available. Monday, January the 29th at 6 p.m. at the Civic Center. And we'll make these dates and times available. I just want you to know there's four opportunities for you to be trained if you want to be involved. Tuesday, January the 30th at 6 p.m. at the Civic Center, okay? And if you can go onto their web page and stuff, you can find this information. It's all right there. You say, why are you taking time for this on a Sunday morning? Because I think it's very important that we be involved in this. I think it's very important that we show our desire and our participation in being involved in winning souls. Hallelujah. Glory. And I think it's very interesting that it's at the beginning of the year. You know, first fruits is very important. First fruits very important. And like Dorcas said, we're reading through the Bible. It's very easy to do that. If you don't know how to do it, all you have to do is go to the App Store and look for this for Bible version of Bible studies, and you have this thing called YouVersion, and you go to plans, and then you go to here to find plans, and then you go down find plans, and you say, well, let's go on, we will, and then you go down to where it says through the Bible. I'm just doing it through the Bible, and you punch that, then it gives you a list of plans that will take you through the Bible in a year. And then on that, you go down and you look for it's bad when the one showing you how to do it messes up. This app right here has a big number one on it, the Bible, and it's called CCV, the Bible in 1 year. You just simply click that, and it'll bring it up, and then it starts you with day one, what you need to read. You can either, when you have the app, you can read it through on the phone, or it gives you what to read in the Bible, or if you have the YouVersion and you have some versions downloaded, like the King James, etc., it'll actually read it out loud to you, and you can read it and follow through with it, which is really, really good. In fact, I've listened to already the first week, and I've done it multiple times because I just can keep it going by playing it, okay? So it's right there. It's easy for you to be a part of, and we encourage you to be a part of that. Amen. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Whew. How's everybody? Hallelujah. I want to give you something I've got in my spirit that I always take a time to get quiet and to listen and to see what the Holy Spirit is saying to me personally and to me as a pastor in the things of the kingdom of God for the year. I keep hearing a couple of things, and I want to share them, and I want to share some scripture with them just to lay some groundwork for the year. I keep hearing in my spirit, you have never come this way before. You have never come or gone this way before. In other words, we are at a point in time where we will and are experiencing things that have been prophesied and foretold for generations. Yet no one else has walked this way before us except God, who is eternal. Now he has, because he knows the end from the beginning. But as far as humanity, the day and the time in which we live is a very, very, very specific time in the plan of God. It's called the last days. Now, when you talk like this, it's not about doom and gloom. It's about God showing in advance what will happen and how certain segments of time will unfold, and they're set by God, and no man can change them. We can't pray and believe God and they change, because God, who is eternal, has set them that way. We can't do anything to change how God has said some things in seasons and times are going to happen. All we can do is discern them, understand them, and cooperate with God in them. Okay? And so we're at a very unique time, and there's a lot of things I can say and share. I've been doing this for 40 plus years, 45, 48 years. So there's a lot of things I can share, but we are at a very, very unique time in history. Prophecy is literally that God foretold and spoke thousands of years ago is now actually unfolding. Boom, 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 boom. Read the Bible, and it's like reading your newspaper. Ezekiel, Daniel, Matthew, Luke, 1 and 2 Timothy, 1 and 2 Thessalonians, other places. It's like reading the newspaper. Just a few things quickly, and then I'm going to get into what I want to share. In March of this year, March, this is January, the World Health Organization is having a meeting with 190 nations already committed to be there. Their intent, very plainly, is, they publicly are saying it, to pass world legislation that will bring every nation that agrees with it and signs onto it into a binding agreement that gives the World Health Organization authority to declare health crises, to define and declare them, and to, from that, take control over every nation that has signed on to that legislation, to tell them what they must do. What shots they must have. I'm telling you, folks, this is March of this year that this meeting is set. What injections they must take, whether they must go into lockdown, whether they must wear masks. I'm not trying to go back and revert to all that stuff, but my point is, every nation that comes into agreement and signs this puts themselves under their authority, and literally the United States is one that is on target, unless there's a change, to sign up for this nonsense. You know what they have over every nation that will sign an agreement with this agreement? The United Nations will be the enforcing power. Or United Nothings, as I call them. Though they should be United Nothings. Be real nice here, but it's a shame America's funding the largest percentage of the United Nations. And then almost submitting ourselves under them. Say, don't be political. No, this is biblical. This is not political. This is biblical. The World Health Organization, everyone that comes under their authority and submits to them, the laws will then be enforced by United Nations troops, which means every nation that signs up under the World Health Organization treaty in March, if it goes through like they're saying it's going to, every nation that does that will then be subject to United Nations troops. Which means if our nation signs it, our nation will be subject to United Nations troops. What that means? They show up at your house and tell you what you're going to do. You say, I want to hear something spiritual. I want to hear something biblical. This is biblical. The Lord's told us about it. Do you know that just recently? You got to be careful here. I don't step on any toes too hard. There was a pact made between the Pope, one of the world's head Muslim imams, and one of the head rabbis of Judaism, where they would put away differences and come together and agree and have one religion to worship God. Now, I've got documentation for all this. I'm not taking time for that this morning because I don't want to do that. And I'm not trying to be real heavy, but this is where we are living, folks. This is the day in which we live, a day that God showed us. Paul wrote about it. Daniel wrote about it. Jesus talked about it. It was recorded. So it's just, it's important that we understand that today is a very, very unique time in history of mankind. It's very unique. There's never been another group of people on the face of the earth that have been at this specific time frame with everything happening in absolute agreement with biblical prophecy to line up for the coming of the Lord. Now, I'm going to say this, and I'm not going to spend a lot of time here explaining it, but I'm telling you, Jesus is coming again. He said he would. If you understand anything scripturally about Bible prophecy, it's time for us to be spiritual adults. And I mean, don't take me wrong. I'm not trying to be mean, but it's time for us to understand. We have to live with an understanding that we are bringing, involved in the bringing of the ages of what's called the church age or the grace age to an end. That's not meant to scare anybody, but God set it that way. He said, here are the things that will be happening when this is coming to an end, and you will know because you will see this. How many of you know we're averaging 2,000 earthquakes a day? We haven't had one here that I'm aware of, have we? At times, if we're not careful, we don't understand. Everything that Jesus told us would happen at the end of the age is now happening. It must be told, it must be heralded, it must be proclaimed so that people are aware of where we are. So we have a world economy that is teetering on the brink of collapse. Now, hear me. I'm not trying to scare anybody, but if you don't know this, you need to know it. The almighty dollar that we have trusted in is not almighty anymore. It wasn't anyway. The scripture's very clear. There is coming a person who will be raised up, and we can get into eschatological differences. I believe that the church is the restraining factor that keeps him from now being brought to the forefront. But the nations of the earth, I talked to a gentleman. When did we talk with Julius? I don't want to go too much on names. About the Bank of India. The Bank of India, the National Bank of India, a few years back, had the largest holdings of any bank in the world. A very dear friend of ours, who is Indian, first name's Julius, that's all I need to say, because he is alive and ministering in India still, told us personally that the head of the Bank of India visited with him and asked him, Julius, if you got any wisdom for me, if you got any input, any counsel to give me, we see things moving in directions and we don't know what to do. Let me know God knows how to feed us. Let us breathe a moment here. God knows how to feed us. Let me understand, the children of Israel ate angels' food for 40 years. God knows how to bring water from a rock. I've driven a car for an hour and a half with no gas in the tank, or it was on empty, and God kept multiplying the gas until I pulled in the driveway where I had to arrive at, and then it died. I'm just saying, we serve a God of miracles. So God takes care of his children. He takes care of his people. He's going to provide. He's going to supply. He's going to provide in all things. So we're not talking about fear. God's not giving us a spirit of fear. But to know where we are in time is critical for us. It's critical for us. You know why? If you don't know what time it is, you might think it's time to go to sleep, and really it's the time to be the most awake you've ever been in your lifetime. We don't want to sleep when we should be wide-eyed, and as they say, bushy-tailed. We don't want to go to sleep. We want to be wide awake. You know, the scripture does a lot of talking about the word sober. Be sober. And we think, well, I ain't been drunk in a while. That's not what it's talking about. To be in control of your mind, have your faculties under control, be very concise in your thinking, where you are on target absolutely in a proper way with the way you're thinking. And so the day that we're living right now, I hear this again and again in my spirit. You have never come this way before. Let me ask you, have any of you ever seen the things going on that are going on right now? Because they've never happened. In some degree, some of them have happened when nations have adjusted and things have happened. But for everything to line up now as things are lining up, it is an absolute clarion call that must be declared. Jesus is coming soon, and the church must be ready, and the church must see what's happening and know what's happening, and we've got to be very intentional. Here's what else I hear. Be very intentional. How many of you accidentally came here this morning? I mean, you didn't plan on coming to church. You didn't plan on going anyplace. You didn't plan on getting out of the bed. You just wound up here. No, you intentionally did some things. What do you mean? You prepared. You took some precise steps to position yourself to be here this morning. Or you'd still be in bed. You know what? When I got out of the house this morning, real early this morning, it was cold. It was dark. Just me and the Lord here. Wasn't anybody else. And I, sure, my body would have said, hey, roll over again, Beethoven. Huh? No. I said, no. I've got to do some things today. I've got to be someplace today. I've got to be on target today. I have some things to accomplish today. I'm not letting all this determine my destination. You know, Dorcas and I went to see our son who lives in Cabot, Arkansas. Cabot's not in the middle of nowhere, but it's pretty close. We love it. Cabot's a beautiful town out in the middle of nowhere in Arkansas. When we began to plan to go, one, we decided where we were going. We decided our destination. And then we decided, how are we going to get there? What do I have to do to get there? If I get out on the road and I go west, I'm not getting to Arkansas. Well, I can if I want to go all the way to the East Coast and then make a U-turn and come back, or West Coast and then make a U-turn and come back. No, there was an intention. In fact, this phone helped us. I put in here where we wanted to go, and I put in here, get me my destination, give me the route. You know what it gave me? 5 choices. Now, they all ended up there, but they weren't all the same road. I wanted the quickest route. I wanted the most direct route. I wasn't looking for the scenic tour. I've been on the scenic tour before. I wanted the direct route, and that was still 11 hours. My point, right now, for believers, it's time to be very intentional in our life. Very intentional. Let me give you a couple definitions here to help you. Here's some synonyms. You know what a synonym is? What is it? Shared meaning. Words that have shared meaning. Different words, but have meanings that are similar and alike. Here's some words that. Deliberate. You know what deliberate means? Vocabulary. What does deliberate mean? Intentionally? Deliberately. I deliberately did something or didn't do it. Means I made a choice, and it was absolutely intentional. Notice, here's some shared meanings with the word intentional. Deliberate, planned, Everybody say planned. You know what? You planned to be here. You say, yeah, you planned to be here. Studied. Huh? Studied, intentional. You thought about it. You studied it. Designed. Purposed. Calculated. Here's one. Calculated. It's a very calculated, intentional, deliberate decision. Willful, premeditated. Huh? Premeditated. Listen, I don't know about you. I know I'm not perfect in every area of my life. I depend upon the goodness of God, but I am absolutely premeditated that I am going to serve God no matter what. Prearranged, here's one, done on purpose. If we would, you know, was just thinking, the road's going out of Del Rio. Let's see. We have 90 West, right? Old 90, which branches off. Basically, we have 277, right? Talking about the major points of demarcation from here. We have 90 East. We have, what is it that goes to Eagle Pass? What is that, 90? What is that? Is it 277? So 277 east. Notice four major roads. We've got some other little, you know, minor roads. For me to get to a certain place, I have to be determining ahead of time, here's where I'm going. I'm on a journey. This is where I'm going. I know somebody else may be going someplace else, but here's where I'm going. This is my destination. I'm choosing to go here. I'm making a calculated decision about my life and the destination that I am intending to be. Let me understand. Joshua said, choose this day who you will serve. You know what that is? A calculated, intentional decision. Calculated. Why? Because everybody's not going to serve the Lord, and everybody's not going to pat you on the back when you determine you're going to, and everybody's not going to cheer you on. Everybody's not going to celebrate the fact that you decided to put your trust in Jesus. Everybody's not on the same team. People say, well, you know, I just want everybody to like me. Well, I'll tell you what I want. I want God to be pleased. I learned years ago that every decision I make, every decision a person makes sets them on a pathway in a certain area. And there are consequences and there are repercussions from every decision. And that decision sets them in a pathway. And many times people don't think about the end result. They think about the now decision. Or you hear me? Many times people do not think about the end result of a journey, of a road that they've chosen to get on. Instead, they end up somewhere shipwreck or in a ditch. Instead of saying, I want to go here, and to go there, I've got to get on this road, and I've got to do these things intentionally. Intentionally. So let's talk about inspiration. Let's talk about goosebumps. No, I don't want to talk about goosebumps. Now, you can get goosebumps if the wind blows across your face. I'm not trying to be, no. Those things, there are a lot of things that people put great value in, that have no eternal value, that do nothing for their destiny. And instead, it's a decision. It's right decisions. It's putting ourselves in the place where we are moving and walking and obeying and positioned ourselves intentionally. Everybody say intentionally. You know what intentionally means? You determined ahead of time. And whenever you do something intentionally, it automatically tells you it may put you in conflict with somebody else. Because if someone else doesn't value your destination and your journey, they may not agree with what you have decided to do. I hear the Holy Spirit say, you've not come this way before, gone this way before. You got to be very intentional. Everybody say intentional. I'm taking my time. I could be moving real fast. Intentional. The Apostle Paul to the church at Galatians said, don't be fooled. God is not mocked. Whatever a man sows, that shall he also reap. He that sows to the flesh shall of the flesh reap corruption, that which corrupts or destroys. He that sows to the Spirit shall of the Spirit reap life everlasting. Phillips' translation says this, and I like it. A person's harvest in life is determined solely by the seeds they sow. You know what that means? A person that wants tomatoes absolutely intentionally does not plant corn. So this is real deep, Pastor. It's about as deep as it gets, because Genesis 8, God said, as long as the earth remains, seed time and harvest shall not cease. Long as this earth is functioning in its present condition and situation, seed time and harvest shall not cease. You know what that means? The determining factor in every life is a seed, which is a choice. The usage of something in a particular way that will produce a particular harvest. Every seed, Genesis 1, the law of Genesis, every seed produces after its own kind, which means, why did God do that? I get tickled at people say, well, you're just wanting to manipulate God. How do seeds manipulate God? God set up the system. He said, you sow a seed, you're going to get a harvest from a seed. In other words, you determine the harvest by the seed. If I refuse to plant a kernel of corn in the ground, I intentionally do not want corn coming up in my flower bed around my house. So I intentionally do not plant a kernel of corn in the ground. Why? Because I hate corn? No, I don't want a harvest of corn there. What do I want? Flowers. So what do you need to plant? You say, Pastor, you get deep. Pretty deep. What do you plant if you want a flower? What flower seed do you plant to get a flower? Is there only one flower seed? Is there only one type of flower? I'm seriously. First you decide, I want flowers. Woo, I want some flowers. Then you say, well, what kind? My wife's mother is in heaven. Her name was Pansy. Where do you think that name came from? You know why? When she was being birthed, her mother looked out the window of the house where she was being birthed and saw pansies. She thought, I kind of like those. Those are beautiful. In the midst of my birthing pain, dealing with my birthing, there's beauty coming. Hello? And when the beauty came, she said, oh, Pansy, you're so beautiful. Notice if you want pansies, you say, Pastor, you get deep. If you want pansies, there's only one specific seed that'll give you pansies. God's being mean. Won't let me just plant one thing and get everything. No. He gave control of your life into you as you serve him, deciding what seeds you want to plant for what harvest you want to receive. How ignorant we would be to chew on a farmer. All right, farmer, just planting rice. Just wanting acres and acres and acres of rice. What's the matter with him? That goofy man, why didn't he plant? No, he wanted rice. That's why he put rice in the ground. My point, intentional. A person's harvest in life is determined specifically by the seed they sow, which means if I don't want something that's in me today or in my life today, it's there because of seeds I sowed. I got to sow some other seeds. If I want to receive what God has for me and I want to walk with God in the midst of this kind of junk that's going on in the earth, I've got to sow specific seeds. I have to be intentional. You have to be intentional. We have to be intentional. Intentional in what? Worship. I don't feel like worshiping God. Kind of tired this morning. Hey, my back hurt me a little bit. Oh, well, my knee there now, it hurt me. Oh, I've got a headache. I'm tired. I worked hard. Now I know this sounds goofy. I understand. I'm taking it to, but understand, worship is intentional. Most of the time when I worship, I don't feel like it. Hallelujah. Pastor, you're helping yourself. Go right ahead. Thank you. No, it's intentional. When I lift my hands, it's intentional. And nobody got a gun in my ribs, lift your hands up. But the scripture says, lift up your hands in the sanctuary. Well, I would never do that. Why not? The word says do it. Well, I just don't feel like it and I'm tired. Do something intentional. Hello, I'm not. No, everything's intentional, or else it's the result of doing nothing. What happens in your yard if you do nothing? Hello? Maybe your yard's different than mine. And my house, if I don't do some intentional things, my yard looks just like the wilderness out there. Why? Because that's what naturally in this environment will grow. And they're saying in this sin-filled world, in fallen humanity, there are things that will naturally grow. You don't have to believe for them. In fact, you've got to set yourself intentionally against the flow of those things. In my house, maybe it's different than yours. I hope it is. If it is, you talk to me after church and tell me how you do it. No, seriously, what do? You have to be very intentional. Very intentional. If you don't plant some certain things in your yard, if you don't intentionally fertilize it, if you don't intentionally water it, if you don't intentionally cultivate it, guess what will grow? What will grow at your house? Lots of weeds. Milkweeds that, you know, I guess what they call them. They come up with all those seeds, and if you don't deal with those things, everything around you is that. Or, you know, down here, there's so many things that stick. It's the last time you didn't deal with something in your yard, and you went through barefoot, and you found out you had some goat heads. You know what? Those things grow here. They grow naturally here. I mean, they grow here. You know what you have to do? You have to intentionally do some things so that other growth will come. Other growth. You say, well, I'm tired. I don't feel like getting that stuff out of my yard. Well, that's fine. Don't. Just don't whine to me when you step on them and you're crying and jumping through the yard going, oh, my God, what's that in my yard? No, it grows naturally. You have to be intentional. If I say intentional, whatever you sow to, guess what? You will reap from. God doesn't determine that. You do. He's determined the process, but not the seed. Now hear me. He's determined the process. The process will work. He didn't determine the seed. We determined the seed. Worship. Everybody say intentionally. You know what you have to do? You have to tell your body. My wife won't let me say this word. You have to tell your body, shut up. I don't want to. I just want to be. I want to sit here and let something fall on me. No, you have to be intentional. Worship the Lord. You have to be intentional in loving people. Now, I know you are the most loving thing on the globe, but all those around you are not. You have to love intentionally. You have to forgive intentionally. There's not a person in this room that has not had to forgive or is not in the processes of walking through forgiveness. You do it intentionally. You say, I know he or she did this to me. I know this happened. I know that happened. I know they don't deserve to be forgiven, but I forgive the same way Christ forgave me. It's intentional. And it's truthfully not even for their sake, it's for mine. It's for my sake. Because anytime I don't forgive, I bind something to me that's held to me until I come to the place of forgiveness. Intentional. What do you mean? It's called a decision.
Well, I'll tell you what. I ain't gonna forgive until.
Here's the until. Until Christ forgave you. Hello? Everybody say intentional. What we do in walking with God is intentional. It's intentional. So we have to intentionally worship, intentionally pray. How many of you just go, oh, I'm going to pray. Oh, been a few times when I was like that. Not very often. You know what it is normally? Thank you, Lord. I give you glory and I give you praise and I come to bow before you and I come as an humble child to fall at your feet, to commune with you. Dorcas, I'm telling on her. I'm coming over here when I do it. She was awakened real early in the morning the other morning. And that's not unusual. I mean, we're pretty much that way. Usually 3 o'clock is kind of, see if the Lord wants me to say anything or go back to sleep. But she was talking about, she was awakened. She's having trouble going back to sleep. So she got her Bible and began to read. You know what happened? I'm not telling on her. If you're going to be in the Word, you got to be in intentionally. You have to set time. Listen to me. You have to set time. This year is an intentional time. You have to set time. If you say, well, when I wake up, You have to set time where you say, I have an appointment. I love that one song. I don't think I'd ever heard that about We Depend on You. That new for here? I mean, did you get that this morning? How many times? We depend on you, Lord. We depend on you. You know what that's saying? I can't. I intentionally come to you. I intentionally focus on you, Lord. I intentionally move back to you. I have to have you. The Lord said, we got to live intentionally. Live intentionally. Everybody say intentionally. Say, Pastor, give me something deep. I am. Live intentionally. Now listen, if you understand the scriptures, and I'm not going into them in great detail because it'll take me a different direction. If you understand the scriptures, the day in which we are living, the Bible says, is a very, very dangerous day. Now you can bury your head in the sand and say it's not, and it's not going to affect me. If you do, we'll pick up your carcass off the side of the road. You say, Pastor, be positive. No, I'm telling you. This is a perilous, which means a time filled with peril. You know how you live in a time of danger? Very intentionally. You live intentionally. You don't allow yourself to be pulled off to the right or the left on stuff. You get on the pathway that you're supposed to be on. You pursue. You watch Jesus. You listen to Jesus. You're in the Word. You're communing with the living Word. You're in the written Word. Holy Spirit's ministering to you. You continually die daily. You say, Lord, teach me. Lord, show me. Lord, speak to me. Lord, help me. Lord, I can't do it by myself. Hello? You've never come this way before. Tell somebody. Tell them. You've never come this way before. You've never gone this way before. I promise you, none of you have ever lived in this era like this, in this time frame, in this season. Things are changing, and they're going to continue. The Lord knows. He was way ahead of it, so there's no reason for us to be scared, but we do have to be alert. 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 Why? One of the things that the Apostle Paul said is he said, in this day in which we live, right now, everybody say right now, some will depart from the faith. You have to be someplace to depart from it. Brother John Osteen, one of my pops used to always say this. It's not good English. He used to say, you ain't never come back from someplace you ain't been. He said, some shall depart from the faith. He tells us how and why. Giving heed. You know what that means? What does it mean to give heed? Give attention to, listen to, embrace. Giving heed to seducing spirits and doctrines of devils. Seducing spirit is an antichrist spirit, a spirit that at its very core and root is against God and his way and his purposes and his plan, but is very subtle. Jesus said, Matthew 24, take heed that no one deceive you. Why would Jesus tell us that unless it could happen? Why would Jesus tell us that unless it was going to happen? By paying heed, giving attention to seducing spirits and doctrines of devils. What does that mean? There will be, at this point that Paul was talking about, by the Holy Ghost, by the Spirit of God, there will be systems in place that will teach you things that are anti-Christ at their very flow, and they will move you away from the truth of God. Now hear me. Pastor, give us some good news. I've got good news for you. The good news is Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. The good news is the Word of God is eternally established and settled in heaven. And it is the truth. John 17, Jesus said, you're sanctified, set apart in the world from the junk of the devil by the truth. You know, when Paul, writing to Timothy, he's talking 1 Timothy and 2 Timothy, about 3 years between the two. He goes into all this stuff, a lot of it. You know what he says again and again and again? Preach the word. Teach the word. Speak the word. Stay with the word. You know why? People's revelations will change, and it doesn't even mean they're necessarily God. I'm not against revelations. I believe in revelations. But I believe in revelation from the Holy Spirit in line with the Word of God. How do we judge a revelation? It's got to line up with the Scripture. Got to line up with the Scripture. If it doesn't line up with the Scripture, don't even listen to it. Don't even give place in your heart about it. Don't even embrace it. Why? There's seducing spirits and doctrines of devils that intend to lead a person, and that scripture does not mean that a person makes this adamant decision like today, like, okay, I reject God. I'm not listening to God anymore. I'm not having anything to do with God. I don't believe in Jesus. You know what it means? Here's what it means. You're at this point. Things are around you, coming in. You're listening, you're receiving, you're thinking. You begin to give place to things in you that are not in line with the scripture, and they begin to slowly, gradually, instead of this way, they begin to move you off in a slight direction. Help me understand, it doesn't take but just a slight degree of turn on your steering wheel to get your car ending up someplace far different from where you intended to be. And again, I'm not saying it to be scared. The scripture says, if you abide in me and my words abide in you, if you live in my word, if you listen to the Holy Spirit, if you commune with Jesus in the midst of all this stuff, the Holy Ghost and the word will work together, and you will know the truth, and the truth will make you free. It'll give you freedom from what? Seducing spirits and doctrines of devils. You say, why do we have to talk about this in the day in which we live? Because Paul, by the Holy Spirit, specifically defined the day in which we live. He said, you take heed. No man deceive you. You take heed. So we have to be intentional. Everybody say intentional in my worship. Intentional in prayer. And I'll tell you this, if you're baptized in the Holy Ghost, filled with the Spirit, with the utter, with speaking, with the ability to pray in an unknown language, you better do it a bunch. It's not my teaching today, but I can show you very plainly. You pray the mysteries of God and revelation into your spirit concerning the truth by doing it. Pray intentionally. Get this one. Get this one. Be still and listen intentionally. Let me understand, when you get with God, it does not always need to be, oh, Lord, I thank you. Gimme, gimme. My name's Jimmy. Gimme, gimme. What do you need to do? Psalmist said it this way, be still. Be still. And know that I'm God. Huh? Intentionally use your faith. Intentionally believe God. Intentionally read, meditate, dwell in the Word of God. This book of the law shall not depart out of thy mouth, but you shall meditate therein day and night, that you may observe to do according to all that's written therein. Then you shall make your way prosperous. Then you shall have good success. Intentional. Now listen, listen. I'm going to say this. Be careful. Intentional living means we judge everything in our lives. How many of you have more than 24 hours in a day? Anybody in here got special privilege? Being facetious, of course. No. Your time is the foundation of your seed sown in your life. There are some things that we used to give time to that are just not worth giving time to anymore. Why? The harvest of them will not facilitate my staying on target with God. We're going to love intentionally. We're going to forgive intentionally. We're going to share the love of Christ intentionally. We're going to fellowship intentionally. We're going to serve intentionally. We're going to give intentionally. We're going to receive intentionally. And I've got a bunch of scriptures. Paul to the church at Corinth, he said, look, you run in a race, you run it to win. He said, everybody that runs in a race is running. He said, but I'm talking to you at Corinth. You run to win. Don't you run for anything else except winning. In other words, finishing in approved fashion. He said, you run to win. You keep your body controlled. Why? Your body wants to do what it is. Dirt. People say, what are you talking about? No, I thank God for the house we live in. But this is my house. It has the capacity to be touched and touch the natural arena, which can be God or can be not God. People won't get hands laid on them and get lust of the flesh cast out. And you can't cast out lust of the flesh. You crucify them. Scripture says you mortify the deeds of the body, which means you put them to death, or you determine they are not having control over you. Which means from your spirit, you say, you build up your spirit, man. You renew your mind with the word, and you say, body, no. And there's not a one of us that does not have to do this. Don't look at me like... You know what that is? It's a difference in one small piece of pie or the whole pie. It's a difference in rolling over in bed or getting up and spending time with the Lord. Intentional. I'm stopping. But intentional. This year is going to require you to be intentional. You say, I am intentional. Judge yourself. Judge yourself. There's a couple things right now that are not sin for me, but the Lord's saying, I ain't doing nothing for you except burning your time and not facilitating harvest of the kingdom in you. Now, maybe God doesn't talk to you like that, but that's okay. He does me. I think he does if we listen. Paul to the Jewish church said, let us lay aside. Everybody, let us lay aside what? Who can finish it? Let us lay aside what? Every weight and the sin which doth so easily beset us, and get this, let us run with patience. And what that means? Intentionality and determination. The race that's set before us. How do we do it? Very plainly. Looking unto Jesus, the author and the finisher of our faith. You say, Pastor, you sound like you're kind of expecting some difficult things. I'm expecting the goodness of God in the land of the living. I'm serious. I'm telling you what I'm expecting. But I also am not ignorant to what the devil's doing. Apostle Paul said, don't you be ignorant of the devil's devices. Don't you go to sleep and think that it's not things are not happening around you. Because guess what? All around you, the devil's working. You say, well, you're glorifying the devil. No, it's a fact. How could things be where they are right now in some situations except the devil's working? Told me 15 years ago where some things would be. I'd go, I don't know if I don't know. I know what the word says, but man, I don't know how. I don't know. I mean, seen how fast things can change. Hallelujah. Glory. Everybody say intentional. With the help of the Lord, I'm going to be intentional. I'm going to be intentional. Now, again, that means you will intentionally do some things and you will intentionally not do some things. You'll intentionally watch some things. You'll intentionally not watch some things. You'll intentionally listen to some things. You'll intentionally not listen to some things. You'll intentionally go some places. You'll intentionally not go some places. You'll intentionally be with someone. You'll intentionally not be with someone. You'll intentionally make your decisions based upon harvest that will come from that seed sown. What's our governing factor? Jesus and his kingdom. Hello? I know this is not jumpy shouty, I understand. Very intentional this year. Very intentional. Very intentional before God. Why? I don't care how long you've lived, you have not come this way before. I don't care how long or short we've lived, we have not come this way before. I remember saying the children of Israel had not gone the way that they were going. And God said, here's what you got to do. You got to look to the cloud every day, every day, every day, every day. Moses would go to the tent and say, let God arise and his enemies be scattered. He'd look to see what God was saying and doing. You are the temple of the Holy Ghost. You are the temple of the Spirit of God. You are the temple. A lot of scriptures, but I'll stop. Hallelujah. Let me pray real fast. Michael, let me lead us in something here. Let me pray over you. Father, in the name of Jesus, thank you for this great, great year that is to unfold in front of us. That faith is now, right now, we understand you're working, you're leading, you're moving in every heart and every life. Now, Father, I agree with what you have said unto me, and I lean into it, that we will live, help us, Holy Spirit, remember, live intentionally. Live intentionally. Sow your seed in whatever area it is intentionally for God's desired harvest. Father, I thank you. I thank you. Our eyes are upon you. You're able to do exceeding abundantly above all we can ask or think according to that power that is at work in us. We listen. We live intentionally because you are ahead of us in all things. With us now and ahead of us in all things. Father, in the name of Jesus, we give you praise and glory and honor. We exalt you and glorify you and magnify you. Michael and them are going to lead us in a song, worship, whatever, as we close. If you need prayer, if you're here and you want prayer for anything, as we start this year out, if it's physical or financial or relational, if there's something that you're dealing with that you want prayer about, we're going to ask those that are here, our prayer team, if they would come up real quickly this morning. If you're here and you would like to pray, we want to make prayer available. We believe God for a good start for you this year and for intentional living this year. have you understand you need to leave intentionally. You've got to make a commitment to that and ask the Lord to help you day in, day out. Nobody else walks the same walk that you walk, but day in, day out, day in, day out. So if you're here and you need prayer, you want prayer for anything, darkness come up, let's join here. We have some that are out today. Hallelujah. You're welcome to come up for prayer or just sit or stand or worship or go whenever you're done. But we invite you for prayer if you want prayer for anything this morning. Glory to God.
Mercy never fails.